So the public disclosure of Dirty Cow, or CVE-2016-5195, just happened. This vulnerability is ancient and allows a regular user on a system to perform a local privilege escalation and become root. I want to show it to you, explore how it works, and generally talk about it. Let's cut right to the chase and start by looking at the provided proof of concept exploit. I've here a vulnerable Ubuntu system where I can download and compile the exploit. Then I create a file owned by root to that I, as a normal user, can't write to. I can read it, but not write. This is true for many files on the file system, like for example the ping binary. Ping belongs to root and has the setuid bit set. This means anybody can execute it and it will run as root, but ping doesn't do much except sending out some network traffic. So our root file we just created resembles a file or a binary like ping. It's owned by root and we can write to it. Now when we execute Dirty Cow and pass it the root file and specify a string we want to write, we can observe that the string got written to the file. We, as a regular user of the system, have written to a root file that we don't have write access to. This is insane. Now imagine we could have written a backdoor into the ping binary, we could become root anytime without knowing the password of root. Now let's try to understand the exploit code. Let's check out main first, where the code starts. So first it opens the file we want to write to as read only. Next comes a call to mmap. Mmap is used to create a new mapped memory segment in the current process. One of these parameters can be a file descriptor, and in this case it's the read-only file owned by root. This means it maps the file into a new memory area. Also, the permission flags show that this memory area is read-only. So far so good. The other important flag is the map private flag. The comment here is copied from the man page of mmap and it states that this creates a private copy and write mapping, or short COW, cow. This is where one part of the name for this vulnerability is from. Mmap doesn't copy the whole content of the file into memory. Mmap maps the file into your memory. This is awesome because you don't need huge amounts of RAM to load a copy of the file. You just directly read from the file on disk. Or relatively directly, we will learn about memory in a second. And copy on write means that if you were to write to this memory segment, you would then create a copy of it. So even though the file was mapped as read-only, because of the private mapping, we can write to a copy of it. So the important takeaway here is that mmap will map the root file directly into your memory and you can read the content of the file or write to a copy of it. The changes to your copy should not be propagated to the real underlying file. It's just for you. Next, we start two threads that will run in parallel. Dirty Cow is a race condition vulnerability. This means certain events have to occur in a special order that are fairly unlikely to happen under normal circumstances. So you try to race against the probability of it not happening, and you simply try it over and over again, and maybe you get lucky. So let's see what the two threads are doing. The first thread is the mAdvice thread. This thread uses the syscall mAdvice, which probably doesn't stand for memory advice, but for mad advice. I think the marketing department failed here, naming this vulnerability not mad cow, am I right? Okay, done with the dad jokes. So this syscall can be used for optimization reasons. You can provide the kernel some information on how you intend to use a memory mapped area, because there are different techniques how you handle caching, look ahead, and so forth. And the one advice we give the kernel is that the memory area we mapped the file to, or at least the first 100 byte, is probably not needed soon. We say that with the mAdv don't need flag, which stands for do not expect access in the near future. For the time being, the application is finished with the given race, so the kernel can free resources associated with it. Subsequent access of pages in this range will succeed, but will result in reloading of the memory content from the underlying mapped file. The last sentence is key to the exploit. Otherwise, not much else happening here. The other thread, procselfmem thread, opens the file procselfmem, which is a special file, and I try to explain really quick. So proc is a so-called pseudo file system. In fact, most resources on Linux are managed as files. So you should always see files in quotation marks when talking about them. imagine a file just to be something you can read from or write to. So this could be a printer, and writing to the printer file could result in an actual physical printer printing the string on a piece of paper. So proc does not really contain files in the common sense. They refer to something more general. Most importantly for our case, something you can read and write to. So in this case, proc self refers to a special file provided for the current process. So every process will have its own proc self. And in there is a file called mem, which is a representation of the current process memory. So you could theoretically read your own process's memory by reading from this file. Now in this case, the exploit writes to this file in a loop. So first it performs a seek, which moves the current cursor to the start of the file that we mapped into memory, and then it writes the string we pass via the program arguments to it. So this will trigger a copy of the memory so that we can write to it and see these changes, but remember, we will not write to the real underlying file. So if you would do these things once or just isolated from each other, probably nothing would happen, because that would be the expected result. But because there is a race condition issue somewhere, trying this over and over again will create a weird edge case. That usually doesn't occur, but in this case, it tricks the kernel into actually writing to the underlying file. Now let's have a look at the patch, because I think it's very interesting and not very big. So in the comment message, the author states that this is an ancient bug that was actually attempted to be fixed once, badly by me 11 years ago, but was then undone due to problems on S390. So I'm a little bit disappointed here at my IBM friends, because they almost have partial guilt here. S390 is the architecture used by IBM mainframe system set. Anyhow, let's have a quick look. The file that is patched belongs to the Linux memory manager, hence the MM directory. And the file itself is called GUP, which stands for Get User Pages. VM stands for Virtual Memory, and PTE for Page Table Entry. I think that should help you a little bit to understand the code. So when you want to write to this mapped memory, the kernel has to copy it, because you are not allowed to write to the underlying file, but a copy takes time. Now usually you do the copy once and you are fine, but in this case we call M advice with don't need over and over again. Let's look this up in the code. So if this flag is used, this function is executed, and the kernel source code explains that the application no longer needs these pages. If the pages are dirty, it's okay to just throw them away. The app will be more careful about the data it wants to keep. I guess I quickly explained dirty. When you read and write to disk, you never do this directly. That would be way too slow. So you cache or buffer them. This means you hold this data somewhere, and at some point in time, you write it to disk. Okay, so if you read the data from disk into memory, you can just leave it there in the cache for further reads. But if you want to write to disk, you write it into this cache buffer, but now you have to tell the system that this buffer got touched and it's dirty now. It's not clean fresh memory anymore. In this case, the system has to make sure that the change is properly propagated to the underlying physical memory, let it be a file on a disk or flash memory. So in this case, if you wrote to the copied mmapped memory, the memory page got flagged dirty. And because you tell the kernel now that the page is not needed anymore, this means you don't care that the dirty page has not been written yet, you just toss it. So the mAdvice call causes the throwing away of this memory. This means it's not in any of the memory caches anymore. This is important for the exploit, because this means every time when we try to write to it again, the copy of the memory might have been tossed. So we have to reload a new copy from memory so we can write to it. And creating this copy takes time, and this is the race condition if the copy and write cycle is not complete yet. The patch added this function that checks if the copy and write is complete, and only then allows writing to it. To be honest, I don't understand this code really to tell you why the snippet makes sure that the copy and write is complete, but it added some additional checks, so I assume it's fine now. So there's the mental picture of our race condition. We constantly use mAdvice to drop any cached copy of the mapped file, and at the same time we try to write to it, which causes a copy of that memory. Now in some rare condition that can be hit very reliably by trying over and over again, we perform the write to the memory before the page table is updated to point us to our copied version, and we write to the real file instead of the copied memory. So the crazy thing about this vulnerability is that it has been in the kernel for a very long time. And it was even a known issue, according to the patch author, that had been attempted to patch it before. So over time, this apparently theoretically raised condition got viable because our system got faster and faster. And Peter Matosek also states that this was an O-Day exploit used in the wild. So there was a real threat. Now, a bit of controversy, and this goes into the unresolved debate that has been going on for decades about how to do vulnerability disclosure. If you were the person who found this exploit in the wild, what would you do? The obvious arguments are full disclosure, because it was actively exploited. Fully disclosing it right away would have not given advanced attackers anything new, but the knowledge would have allowed system administrators to immediately patch their systems. But on the other hand, it's such an easy and widespread vulnerability that a full disclosure would have allowed armies of less skilled hackers to take advantage of it, until less professional admins or private people could patch it. On the other side, we have the responsible disclosure, where you first contact the developers, create a fix, try to roll it out, and then tell people afterwards. The obvious arguments here are you stop professional sysadmins from hot patching their systems quickly and leave them exposed for the ongoing attacks. Now, I don't know what is the best way. Both ways have advantages and disadvantages, and it entirely depends on your threat model. In general, I lean slightly more towards full disclosure because I like information to be free, though I myself do responsible disclosure because I'm a hypocrite. I hope you like this kind of exploit walkthrough video and that I could show you something new and interesting. If I said something wrong or you have additional info on why this exploit has to be triggered through a write to procmem and not directly writing to the address, please correct me or post additional info in the comments below so that other attentive viewers can benefit from it. Thanks.